I am Marco Forgetta from INFN in Italy. And I will talk a little bit during this Hackfest about the Identity Federation, the Shibboleth software to implement the Identity Federation. This lesson is divided into sections. The first section, I will talk a bit about the Identity Federation, and then I will show you I will provide you some information on how to create your services and how to federate the services and an Identity Federation. So we start with the general idea, because I'm not sure who is confident with the Identity Federation and the terminology and so on. So let's start with the Identity Federation's part. When we go to a web page, almost all the web pages on the internet, you always have the option to sign in when to perform some additional activity on the page or to show some personal information on the page and so on. In the symbols page like Google, everyone, there is, you can find a sign-in options. When you perform the sign-in, what you do is just to provide your credential. Credential can be username and password, can be a certificate for X509, can be a Kerberos token. The credential can be in two-factor authentication, so you have to provide username and password plus some additional information like a one-time token or a biometric, whatever. Doesn't matter. You have to provide a credential, can be everything. And when you provide a credential, the system can identify your identity using the credential you are providing, because the credential are used for two reasons. One, to identify, one, to make sure the one is providing the credential is the right person. So with the credential, you have these two options: identification of the user and linking with user information. Because with the username you are providing, there are all information in Google linked to this username. So it's identification of your attribute, and with attribute all the resources stored on the system, and the identification. After the login page, generally every site will provide you some information about your connected with your identity. So just for the case of Google, you see the logo of the authenticated user, you can access your document in Google Drive, you can see your mail and so on and so forth. When we talk about identity management, we talk about the system behind the web page where you stored the user identity information. So all the credential, all the user attribute, like the username, the real name, the surname, the birthday, whatever information connected with the user, go to the identity management system. In this case, in many sites, the identity management system is integrated, implemented inside the site. So when you install your web tool, WordPress, Joomla, whatever, this tool generally provide an identity management inside the tool. So all the information are stored with the web page. And this is the basic identity management. So you have the web with your identity management inside. You can log into the web. If you have an account on the web page, you can log in, you can get your information and so on. The second part of action related with the identity is the authorization. Just to go ahead with the Google example, when you access to Google with your identity, you have the right to perform some activities. You can have your file on Google Drive, you can have your email, you can check your email, you can write your files. But you can provide, for example, access to your files to other people. In this case, you have to grant authorization. Other people can grant authorization to you. you can have authorization to perform some activities. There will be the Google admin that can perform more activity than you can, because there is a different level of authorization. Almost all the sites have generally three level of authorization, three level. That is the not authorized, not identify the user, so it's the generic user can do nothing, can see nothing or some page depending on the site. There's the basic user that can perform basic activity, there is the admin. And then you can have to this three basic level, you can add other level to differentiate the activity the user can do. More complex is the site, more complex can be the authorization schema, because you can have multiple level where you can grant on a specific action to the user. So we will cover these two aspects in this identity federation, the identity and authorization. We see what we can federate and what we can't federate. So we have seen until now that you can have a website with identity management and authorization. And this is managed by the site. So when you log into the site, your credentials are stored on the site, your authorization are stored on the site, and you can perform action. But this is not this is common as in many sites, but it is not the only option. It's possible also to use remote credential for identification. In this case, the site will not request user credential. Now we delegate the identity management to an external site. This for a couple of reasons. First of all, because users are not willing to provide their credentials to all the sites they go. So they prefer, there is a preference to have a centralized access where you, to a server you trust, and then from that server to go in other site where you eventually can just block the access to your identity information and so on. There's this known advantage. So you can go to a site, you can go another site, you can go a third site and so on. You're moving around the site without the login again and so on. So it's possible to delegate this identity management to an external site. I give just you just an example, but the web is full of websites that delegate the authentication to a remote site. In this case, for example, I go to booking.com is a website for booking hotels. Or you can see you can log in with your credential on the site, but they can also accept credential from Google and Facebook. This means that if you click Google, what's happened is to open the Google login page. So you are logging to Google. You are not logging to Booking, but it's Google that will provide your identity to the booking.com. So the identity management is not anymore performed by the booking.com. This is the first example of transfer the identity management outside from your site or your web application. And this is the base concept that we see in the identity federation is just the delegation of the identity management to a different application external to your site. This is made for many reasons. One, I said before, is the single sign-on. If you have multiple sites connected with a single identity management, like Booking, Dropbox, Google itself, then you can go from one application to the other application without logging again. You can move entirely stuff with one. You can have some connection between information Dropbox with information Google Drive because everything is connected with your identity, so it's easier for you to connect information on Google with information Dropbox because the identity behind is the same. They are linked in some way using your identity. So you have a lot of advantages to have this connection because you limit the number of username and password you have to remember. You have information linked, so it is a it is easier for you to move from one site to the other and connect the information on Google Drive with Google Gmail or whatever with information on Dropbox, information on booking.com, because everything is yours, is connected to your identity. So all resources managed by Google, Dropbox, and Booking, in this case, are all your resources, and they can be grouped together. And this is the single sign-on idea. This is what we have for normal websites that you can go surfing on the internet. Now we go to a more... now we move the focus to the research activity, to the university research center, where they use the SAML technology to implement this single sign-on and this remote identity management. This SAML, where SAML is a language specifying a set of messages to exchange between two sites to exchange identity information. In some technology, we distinguish two main resources. One is the identity provider, and the other is the service provider. The identity provider is the application process managing the user identities. The service provider is the application consuming user identity. So, if you think about web, for example, the case of Google and Booking.com, if we talk in terms of SAML, then the Google login is the identity provider. Booking.com is the service provider because Google is the one managing the identity. Booking is the one consuming the identity. So one is the identity provider, the other is the service provider. You have set up this distinction between identity provider and service provider. Even in some special case on the federation, there could be some resources that act as service provider, identity provider at the same time. Depending on the resource is communicating, because there are resources that can operate as service provider when communicate with identity provider. I can operate as service providers and communicate with identity providers. But this is a special case. We will not go into the detail of this special case. What you have to know that during the communication, you have always to distinguish between identity provider and service provider. A federation, so some federation, is just a group of resources. So a group of identity providers and service providers that sharing some common policies. Sharing a common policy. So all the resources are subscribing a policy that is managed by the federation organization. So all the and all these resources are managed as a single entity. So when you configure the resource in your service provider, your identity provider, you have not to specify the service, but you have to specify the federation. So they are managed all together. However, even there is the federation, the authentication is always point to point. So the authentication is performed by an identity provider and a service provider. The federation has no action in this authentication, but the role of the federation is to create a trust between the identity provider and the service provider. With the trust means that the identity provider will trust the information, the service provider will trust the information coming from the identity provider. The identity provider will trust the requests coming from the service provider. This is the trust established by the federation, and this is established when they group together all the resources. This is the role of the federation, just create a trust. There is no part on the authentication made by the federation. So how the authentication works? The authentication, the user go to the service provider, that is a page, where the user go to the login, like you normally do with every web page. So the user goes to the login. The user is redirected to the discovery service when the user clicks login. The discovery service is another service that is show the list of IDP, because in a federation you may have multiple IDPs. You have generally one ADP for organization joining the federation. So you have multiple ADPs. So the discovery service show the list of IDP to the user. This can be an external services managed by the federation, for example, or can be embedded to the your service provider. So your service provider, when you click login, show a page with the list of IDP coming from the federation. So the user go back from the discovery service to the service provider, to the login page, with the ID of the own IDP of the user. So the services provider can send the user to the selected IDP, where the user has to perform the authentication. After the authentication is performed, the user go back to the SP, so the service provider, where the user is authenticated. During all the steps, so when the user go to the discovery service, go back to the IDP, go back to the SP, go to the IDP, and so on, all the steps are associated with some SAML assertion. So it's just an XML file describing the action the user wants to perform, with the service asking for the authentication, and what are the attributes requested by the service in order to identify the user, and so on. So the message, all the messages describe the message coming from one endpoint describe the action the user wants to perform to the other endpoint. So if we go to a web page with the SAML Federation, we go want to perform the step I showed before, you have to go to this is a web page from Sci-GaIA project federated with Identity Federation. You go to the login, you are redirected to the discovery service. In this case, it's a multi-level discovery service because the sites support multiple federations. You choose the federation you want, then you have the list of IDP. You choose the IDP, in our case, is IDP open. So you go back to the SP, send you back to the IDP. You cannot see the go back because it's almost immediate. You have nothing shown on your web browser because you have immediate redirect. So you will not see some steps because they are immediate. You go to the IDP, you provide your credential. In this case, it's just username and passphrase. Then you go back to your web page. By this case, you are logged because the IDP will provide the summer session saying, okay, this is Marco Fargetta from INFN with this additional information, like the email, and so on. So the system can authenticate you and provide your resources. In this case, resources mean the information stored in the site. These steps are described as authentication flow. So we have a flow for the authentication coming from the SP, go to the IDP, go back. The flow describes all the steps you have to perform for the authentication. SAML was started for web service. So it is started to authenticate a web application with the remote identity management. However, it is possible to implement also authentication, other type of resources that are different from an application, like a native application or mobile application, and so on, because you have it's possible to have different flow, different authentication flow performing different kind of actions. In the SAML technology, these flows are called as profiles. Each IDP and SP will publish in it to the federation the information about the supported profiles. You can have profiles for web authentication, you can have profile for native application. Even for web application, you may have different profiles. For example, the one most used and we use in the example is the redirect profile, where you are redirect between all the sites. But it's possible to have also different profile, like post profile. It changes the way the user is sent to the IDP, for example, if we change this profile, even for web applications. So it's possible to have different profiles. Generally, the IDP and SP specify the profiles they want to use in order. So the first profile is the one you want to use. If this is not possible, you can use the second and so on. And the system will choose the first match between this list of profiles. Using the SAML, one of the benefits you get is the remote identity management, so your application has not to implement the identity management inside the application. The second is the single sign-on, because the IDP where you log in tracks of your authentication. So when you go to the login and provide a credential, the IDP will create a session for you, storing your information, your login. So when you perform another request to the same IDP, the IDP has not to ask you for credential because you have the session still live. So the IDP can provide your information immediately. There is no need for this authentication again. In this case, it's implementing the single sign-on, because with the single sign-on, what you get is to avoid the continuous request of user credential. Of course, this session has a lifetime, can be configured on the IDP, is not very long. So you have to, but it's enough. The default, I think, is half an hour. So if you go to multiple sites, half an hour is not a problem. But it's configurable, so some IDP can have longer, some IDP can have shortest, and so on. But in any case, you have a single sign-on when you go from one site to the other, you move between sites, you have this single sign-on. Of course, this expiration time is valid for, or even for Google or for whatever. Everyone has an expiration time, unless you use cookies or other stuff that even the IDP can implement. So it's dependent on the IDP. And in play, it's possible to implement the single sign-on. Additionally, when the IDP will authenticate your user, the information are the IDP sent to the SP can be confirmed by the user. This is not implemented by all the IDP, but in many IDP, when you authenticate on the IDP, before to go to the SP, the IDP will ask, okay, the SP will request your email, your affiliation, your whatever information. Are you sure you want to provide this information to the SP? So there's a control on the information you are providing back to the SP. Of course, in the single sign-on, when you log in, if you remember, this is the discovery service. Because if you go to one SP, go to the discovery service, to the IDP. If you go to another resources, you have to remember that also the discovery service will store the information on the selected IDP. So when you go to other services, you have a single sign-on with the IDP, and the discovery service will not show up, because also the discovery service will store this information about the IDP you have used. So every time you go, you will not see the discovery service, even you have some interaction, but it's hidden because it's immediate redirect to the service. So you cannot see the discovery service, even it is there. Of course, the discovery service can store the information forever, or for just for until your browser will close it. It is better to have not this information stored forever, because in case you want to change the IDP for some reason, then could become a problem. You need to clean the cache and so on. It's not very straightforward. I said the other problem related to the identity is the authorization. HSSP, so a service provider, is responsible for the authorization of the user. And the authorization is not federated. So when you go to the SP, the ISP can able to identify you using SAML, but then what action you can do on the SP is only decided by your SP. The federation is responsible only to uniform the attribute. So the information coming from the P, the SP is able to recognize information coming from the IDP, because if they are in the same federation, they agree on the name of the attribute they can share. So all the information comes from the API identified, but then the user authorization is just to decide by your SP. However, SP can get advantages of this identity federation because information coming from the IDP could be used also for authorization. The simple authorization is just to accept all the federated users as user of your system, like I show you in this course. All the users coming from the identity federation are user of this course, they can do whatever, but administration, because the administration requires a special permission, is not provided to SP users. But there is a flat authorization, so all the users from identity, if it is recognized, they are user of this course and they can perform an activity. This is the discourse I show in the previous slide, the discourse of Sci-GaIA, or the form of Sci-GaIA. Discourse is the tool managing the form. An alternative can be using a filter, so because the SP can implement the filter, so you can say, okay, you can ask information to ADP, the ADP can provide the user information, and you say, okay, I can authorize only users that are, in my case, working at the INFN, are authenticated with the INFN ADP, and they are in the position of staff, because the ADP can provide the position inside the organization, for example. Or if it is a new university, I can say, okay, I can provide access to all the teacher as with authorization as teacher, for example, a tool for university, and all the students are students. So you have two different levels of authorization, and this can be managed only with the identity federation. Finally, it's always possible for SP to implement its own authorization system, where the user has to apply for authorization. So the user coming from the federation cannot do any action, just request authorization that the service provider has to grant. So the user coming from the identity provider is authenticated, but not authorized. Then the user is enabled to request an authorization to perform some activity. And this is the more strict approach. There are some tools to provide federated authorization, but they are not widely used by all the federation. From some SP, they are not possible because of the way they want to control the authorization. So they are not very general. They are used in special cases. So I will not focus on them right now. If you want to implement the service provider, identity provider, you have to remember that authentication is point to point. The federation is not repeated. You can create a trust point to point, so you can perform all the activity you want. But you need to implement an identity provider and service, a test identity provider and test service provider, then you can perform all the action of a federation. Because the authentication is point to point. Of course, if you it's possible to put this in a federation, a test federation, like in GridP federation, that is the federation I manage. We provide a test federation where user can try to test the federation with both. They can try to test their test service with them. Other test services or with production services, because the test federation provides access to some production services, some test services, so you can provide interaction into the federation. But it's not mandatory, you can test first between the two services you can manage. And then you can join the test federation before to go to an office of federation. In fact, to join a federation, what you have to do is to have this running service. They should be configured, they should work, so you have to do your test in your services first. Then you have to join the test federation, just to verify if there is some misconfiguration. I don't know, the discovery service is pretty configured, miss some information, and so on. I'm not sure I heard, but the SAML described the message exchange between the identity provider and the service provider, and also the description of the service that the identity that the other services are to have in order to recognize. I mean, if you have the service provider, the identity provider, in order to have this authentication, the service provider has to know the identity provider, and the identity provider has to know the service provider. So they have to exchange some information before to start the authentication. This this exchange is made using SAML. So the SAML describes also the service. And this description requires some additional information for the federation that is not requested for the authentication, but only for the federation. So this your service can have some information missed and so on. So all the technical problems are evaluated during this test of the service. And at the end, if everything is okay, the organization managing the service has to sign an agreement with the federation. So they will comply with the rules decided by the federation for the management of the federation itself. This will require generally some activity on the user policy, because the federation can say how you have to manage the user identity and stuff like that. So you have to comply with these rules. So as I said, when you with some authentication, you can have multiple level of connection. You can have just two resources, an identity provider and service provider, two or more, but a few, and but not too many. And you can connect directly these resources, sharing the task between these resources, sharing the metadata of this, the sum or describing all the resources. You can have a federation where all those resources are grouped together and managed as a single identity with common attributes, with common policy, and so on. And the federation can be a national federation or transnational federation, but with a scope. In this case, I mean with the aims they want to achieve in the federation. So the services and the generally, they work with similar activities. So you have this bunch of results, you have the federation, and then you can have the interfederation. So the interfederation is a federation of federation. And this interfederation, the most relevant interfederation, I don't know if there are other, is EduGain, that is the European interfederation. It's European, but so, because it's founded by the National Federation in Europe, but they accept also transnational federation like GRIDP, because GRIDP is part of this EduGain. And they accept also outside of Europe, like in common in US, like CAFE in Brazil, and other federation around the world. From Japan, I think there is the federation. I'm not sure about China, but there is also, actually, I think there is, I'm not sure if there are federation from Africa, but I'm sure the National Federation in South Africa asked to join EduGain. There is the this week there is an open discussion to decide if accept or not. Generally, this accept or not is for technical reason or for policy. They have to decide the policy of the federation combined with the EduGain policy. Otherwise, the federation can decide if they change their policy to comply with EduGain or just not connect. The interfederation has the advantages that your services in the interfederation can be accessed to all the services in the interfederation. And your user, if you are an identity provider, can access all the services in the interfederation. So for some services, like, I don't know, the research publisher, the like Springer, SAVR, and so on, they can just join the go to everyone through an interfederation. Of course, the authorization is still point to point. So even the services in interfederation, it is not sure the user can access. User can be identified, but it's not sure if the user can perform action because then there is the authorization. And this is not federated. We are talking only for identity federation. Finally, I would give you some additional information because of what is not easily done with SAML, like the delegation. Well, with delegation, which are referring to the bit of a service where you are identified to behave as yourself for another service. So you access a service where you are using SAM, and then you want this service to access another service to perform some activity on your behalf. This is in theory possible with SAM, but it's quite tricky, it's complicated, so it's not really used. And also the other problem is to access REST API. REST API is very common nowadays because they are a very convenient way to share, to allow different services to communicate. And in theory, it's possible to use SAML for REST API because there is a profile for native application that can log in to this REST API because you can protect the REST API with the SAML like you do with the normal web application. So at that point, it's enough to connect. But the problem is that using SAML with the web application, you create a session. So you have a certificate only once. Then all the communication with this web services with the web application using your session, storing your information. You are not requested to authenticate. REST API, on the other hand, are stateless. So there's no state. This means every time you want to access a REST API, you should authenticate. And it will require to go to the DP, provide a credential, return, even if the application is performing this activity. So the user has not to provide a credential every time. But the steps, the additional steps are very demanding in terms of computation because the DP has to log in, has to find on his identity management system with the user information, has to collect them, to create the SAM, to send the SAM assertion, to send to the REST API, this REST API has to verify the signature, has to decrypt if the message is scripted, and so on and so forth. So it's very demanding. Even if it is possible, it is not very recommended. So recently, there is an ARC project in Europe. This is the ARC project Europe. ARC is for authentication authorization for research community. So they aim to define a way for the research community to manage authentication authorization. They propose to integrate some federation with the other system for identity management. So in this case, you can have SAML from some between some services, and then change this SAML assertion with the other with something different, and then use some different with the other service with other services because for other services this other protocol can be better. Like I said, for REST API, for example, what they suggest for REST API, for example, is to convert your SAML assertion with OpenID Connect. OpenID Connect is a protocol including OpenID and OAuth 2.0. So at the end, you will use OAuth 2 token to access the REST API, but use SAML to generate the token, and there is some conversion in the middle. And as an example of an implementation of tool performing this kind of translation is the one implemented in another European project, because the ARC project means only to provide specification. There is this Indigo Data Cloud project. That has implemented the tool for identity management, which is able to perform this translation from SAML or from other kind of authentication to an OpenID Connect token. So if you want to implement the service with REST API, and you want to use SAML for authentication, then you can deploy a service like Indigo YAM, perform this translation, so then the user will get a token to contact the user can authenticate to YAM with SAML, YAML will release a token, and then you can use this token to communicate with your REST API. This is more REST API friendly approach for the instead of SAML. But still maintain some benefit of SAML, like the remote identification, the single sign-on, and so on, because the token is connected with SAML. So the benefit of SAML are translated to the token in some way. Although this adds some complexity to your architecture of your application. Okay, so in summary, the Identity Federation allows to connect service with identity and allow to connect services and perform the implementing your application with the identity management outside of your application managed by different organizations. So users from different organizations can access your application, or user from your organization access remote application and be identified. It's possible to integrate your resources in some federation at a different level. You can even not create a federation, you can create a federation, you can go to another federation and so on. However, for specific protocol could be for specific problem could be better to translate from SAML to other protocol to for a better integration. Thank you. That's all.